Hello and welcome from me, Michael Scotty in Oxford. Thank you for joining us for the 9th event in the second year of our Christian Literary Imagination series. This series is a Georgetown University's humanities initiative in association with Campion Hall, Oxford, and the Las Casas Institute, Blackfriars Hall, Oxford. And today is St. David's Day, thus the daffodil, the patron saint of Wales. And I'm joined by Professor Mike Collins from Georgetown University, who will be talking about the Welsh poets R.S. Thomas and John Ormond. And I know Mike knew John Ormond personally as a friend, so I'm looking forward to this very much. After his talk, Mike will take questions submitted from members of our internationally based audience. We encourage you to participate by typing your questions directly to us from the moment we begin the session. You can do so by using your Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. If you have a question or questions, please ask them and we will endeavour to answer them either today or later by email. Please ensure you use the Q&A button and not the chat button, the Q&A button. Thanks very much. Now, let me introduce Michael J. Collins. He's teaching professor of English and Dean Emeritus at Georgetown University. He is editor of Reading What's There, Essays on Shakespeare in Honor of Stephen Booth, Shakespeare's Sweet Thunder, Essays on Early Comedies, and with Francis J. Ambrosio, who's also spoken on our series, Text and Teaching, The Search for Human Excellence. He's published essays on teaching Shakespeare and Shakespeare in performance in Shakespeare Quarterly, Shakespeare Yearbook, Shakespeare's Newsletter, and Critical Survey, among other publications. He regularly reviews productions of Shakespeare for a Shakespearean bulletin. He has been a member of the faculty on courses for secondary school teachers at the Folger Shakespeare Library in Washington and Shakespeare's Globe in London. I've known Mike for many years. In fact, I first met him in 1987 when he invited me to Georgetown University. And I've been a partner with him many times for various lectures, and I'm looking very much forward to today's event. So with that, over to you, Mike Collins.
Thank you very much, Michael, for that very generous introduction. I certainly hope I don't disappoint you at the end of the lecture. But anyway, we'll begin by talking about John Ormond. I'll tell you a little bit about him and then look at some of his poetry. John Ormond was born John Ormond Thomas on April 3rd, 1923, in Dunvant, a village west of Swansea. English and Welsh existed side by side in the village, but there was little Welsh spoken in his family. He graduated from University College Swansea with an honors degree in English in 1945. After graduation, he became a staff writer for Picture Post and then a sub-editor of the South Wales Evening Post. In 1955, he joined the BBC television service in Cardiff to establish a news department and subsequently became the head of its documentary film unit, a position he held until his retirement from the BBC in 1983. He's highly regarded as a filmmaker as well as a poet. John Ormond published three collections of poems during his lifetime. He died prematurely in May 1990. Pardon me. One of his poems, called Homing Pigeons, first was published in March 4th, 1977, almost 45 years to the day, in the Times Literary Supplement's Six Pages on Wales. They did a special feature on Welsh literature and history. Homing Pigeons was an appropriate choice for an issue focused on Wales because it recalls the traditional Welsh poetic forms that are characterized by strict patterns of alliteration. While it is not his best nor his most ambitious poem, Homing Pigeons suggests in a concise and, I think, accessible form, the vision that animated John Ormond's poetry and the skill, the careful artistry that shaped it. Now, my first challenge is to get the poem up on the screen. Yeah, there it is. Good enough. I hope it works. Can you, okay? All right, there's the poem. out of a parsimony of space unclenched, into the not known and yet familiar. They ascend out of their hunger, the homing pigeons, venture a few tentative arcs, donate new circumflections to the order of strange sky, then blend to a common tangent and so render themselves to the essence of what they are. What beguilement shepherds the heart home? Not what we know, but some late lodestone, which far was always there, drawing us to a meaning irreducible, to a fixed star. Why then the falling, all the fumbling as tumbler pigeons, fools flying with the most inept of masteries, but flying still and, despite awkwardness, being, as best we can, committed in the chance whether we approach to what and where, without a sense of reward, we may reach and trust to be fed. Homing pigeons is a remarkable technical achievement, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that technique, and I hope you'll bear with me. Upon the reflex, the poet struggled to discipline his language so that, as John Ormond once said, the music, by which I mean the sound and the rhythm and the meaning, are made one thing. This is me now. The poem is carefully balanced. Two parallel stanzas of seven lines are joined by a stanza of four lines. In the opening line, parsimony of space, a basket, sounds appropriately clipped and thus produces the rhythmic sense of release in the word unclenched. The periodic structure of the first three lines, which brings particular emphasis to they ascend out of their hunger, seems to reproduce in that third line the upward movement of the pigeons. The next two clauses, roughly parallel in structure, but the second longer than the first, suggests the lengthening arc the pigeons make. Then, with the run-on line and the absence of syntactic breaks in the last two lines, the movement becomes quicker, more fluid, less labored and broken, as the pigeons gather together and fly swiftly and easily home. While the rhythmic movements of the stanza parallel the flight of the pigeons, the words arc, circumflections, and tangent not only describe it visually, but suggest as well the instinctual pattern and order by which the pigeons reveal their essential nature. In the second stanza, a new rhythm underscores the expository qualities of the lines. The question begins the stanza seems quiet, conversational, after the descriptions of the pigeons. It also contains, as John Ormond pointed out, a truly Anglo-Welsh pun, but deeply buried. Beguile in Welsh means shepherd. The next three lines, with the triple stress on late lodestone and the three syntactic breaks, move slowly and tentatively to the emphatic close of the last line, a fixed star. In the third stanza, the alliteration becomes more insistent. The FL sounds at the beginning of the stanza recall the clumsy sounding beat and flutter of wings when we disturb a flock of pigeons. The lines, broken by appositives, suggest the somersaults of the tumbler pigeons whose forward flight is broken by their tumbling. The last four and a half lines, with their several syntactic breaks and their insistent alliteration, are, like the flight they describe, choppy and labored. If I bring that up a little bit, no, I can't, okay. The final five lines form one long periodic sentence. The two phrases that precede the main clause, which is in the last line of the poem, are themselves interrupted three times by parenthetical elements. And thus both the rhythmic movement and the tired syntactic structure, which seems simultaneously to pull us forward and yet unable to reach the final statement we expect, suggests precisely both the mysterious attraction that draws us home and the difficulty of the flight, the tentativeness of the commitment the distractions that can take us off course. The rhythm, the syntax, the content of these lines contrast sharply with those of the first stanza, and so make clear that while we can divine tangents and essences, our emblem is not the homing pigeon, but the tumbler. At the same time, the periodic structure, the frequent parentheses create a sense of expectation by conspicuously withholding the main clause of the sentence. As a result, the last line of the poem, the main clause, when we do finally get there, has, with the heavy stretch on reach, the pause after it, and the gentle fall of trust to be fed, gives the ending a quiet, even triumphant finality, suggests we have at last, indeed, despite all the difficulty, come home. But that quiet, hesitant triumph is further qualified by the words may reach in the last line. For the words seem to admit either of two meanings. We are able to reach, or we may or may not reach. It seems a linguistic instance of the rabbit and the duck. As we hear the line one way, it suddenly reverses itself and we hear it the other way. But what we actually hear is the tension in John Ormond's poetry between order and accident, between meaning and absurdity. John Ormond said that some people have found, notably a lecture in the Society of Jesus, that my poem, Homing Pigeons, is a religious poem. That isn't meant as a religious poem, but the best poems, or those that reverberate most anyway, are those which are saying many things, have layers of meaning that sometimes one wasn't aware of, but nonetheless are there for the finding, have laminations of meaning, unquote. But if Homing Pigeons is read in the context of his other poems, it is difficult to believe that John Ormond did not intend it to be a religious poem, or at least recognize its religious implications. In a longer poem, let me see now if we can get the longer poem up here. Right, share the screen, and boom. That may be a little small, but I think we can do it. In a longer poem, one called Waiting in the Garden, the speaker imagines what it would be like if angels came suddenly down from heaven into the postmodern world in which we all now live. Landing in the garden that his wife, the lady of the poem, has lovingly created behind their house. The angels who arrive are anything but dignified. They fly motorcycles into the garden, clipping the tops of the lilac trees and crash landing in the rhubarb, all that in the first few stanzas. Some, as expected, are old and white bearded. Others are young and carry for identification pictures taken in booths in the far corners of celestial Woolworths. In a poem, let me read part of that. Part of it too. The angels have arrived in the next to last stanza. The angels arrive, but what answer do they bring? What answer not yet given by the evening light and the questions and the pleasances at the table in the green of this lady's garden? And the strong white house, its books and pictures, the questions and children I have pondered in it. Would my most welcome visitors, awkwardly ascending from their failed mission, be stripped of their silver stripes, be heaven-bound, not grounded, confined to base, forfeit their harps? I hope not. Poor lucky souls, knowing the mystery, I'd signal them, good luck, good flying, as the garden dark. in a poem that inevitably calls the mythic apparition of the angel Gabriel to Mary as she reads in her garden, a scene Ormond would have encountered in Frau Angelico's painting in the Diocesan Museum in Cortona, where he spent many summers, the speaker wonders what secrets these angels might tell him, what answer they might give to the fundamental religious question we all confront. Do we live in a sane or a lunatic universe? But then, acknowledging the mysterious paradox of our earthbound lives, he recognizes that whatever answer he might understand has been revealed to him already in the ordinary events of his life. The poem rests on the tension between our longing for certainty and our inability to find it, between the joy that is humanly possible and the darkness that will inevitably overtake it. When he wrote about his work, John Ormond recalled the words of Vernon Watkins, another Welsh poet. "I'm aware," he said, Ormond, "that I am continually concerned with life's miraculous poise between light and dark. Light and dark, joy and sorrow, requiem and celebration," the name of one of his collections of poems, "meaning and absurdity, life and death." These tensions are persistently at play in John Ormond's poetry and shape its vision of the world in which we live. His poem reflects a longing, to use words he borrowed from R.S. Thomas, a longing for signals from an ever-present reality, glimpse of the eternal, sources at which a man can strengthen and renew his vision of an order beyond time. But that longing can never be satisfied. And in the end, the poems find only our own world of time change, with its reason to rejoice and its reasons to mourn. In denying neither the truth of our mortality nor the joys of the mortal world, neither our lust for secrets nor in our inability to learn them, the poetry of John Ormond sees clearly the elemental uncertainty in which we live, and thus resists both the blinding brilliance of presumption and the blinding darkness of despair. John's best work makes clear the joys and sorrows of our own lives, the beauty and fragility of creation, and returns us to the world with a sharpened sense of its wonder and worth. Let me try to show you another poem now. "From where? From whom? Why ask in torment all life long, when, while we live in it? As pointless to ask for truth in pictures that throb in the fire, rustle, then fall into ash, or why stars are not black in a white firmament. Enough that it was given, green as of right, when equally possible, nothing might ever have been." All right, I shall stop the share here and we'll go on. So let's talk about R.S. Thomas. R.S. Thomas was born in Cardiff in 1913 and grew up in Holyhead in north of Wales. He attended University College in North Wales in Bangor and was trained as a priest in the Church of Wales at St. Michael's College in Cardiff. After ordination, he served in various rural parishes in Wales for 42 years. He was nominated for the Nobel Prize in Literature in 1995. He died in 2002 at the age of 87. I should like to begin by comparing, or actually rather contrasting, a poem by Gerard Manley Hopkins by a poem with R.S. Thomas. The poem by Hopkins is one called "Felix Randall." "Felix Randall, the farrier? Oh, is he dead then? My duty all ended, who have watched his mold of man, big-boned and hearty handsome, pining, till time when reason rambled in it and some fatal four disorders, flesh there, all contended. Sickness broke him. Impatient, he cursed at first, but mended, being anointed and all, though a heavenlier heart began some months earlier, since I had our sweet reprieve and ransom tendered to him. Ah, well, God rest him, all road ever he offended. This seeing the sick endears us to them, us too it endears. My tongue had taught thee comfort, touch had quenched thy tears that touch my heart, child, Felix, poor Felix Randall. How far from then forethought of all thy more boisterous years, when thou at the random grim forge, powerful among peers, didst fettle for the great gray dray horse his bright and battering sandal. Through the grace of the sacraments, the priest comforts the farrier and ministers to him as Christ ministered to the sick. And the priest finds comfort as well, for he himself feels God's love through the ministry he carries out. The poem is an elegiac sonnet, and it makes within its 14 lines the conventional elegiac progress from sorrow to joy and hope. The dray horse in the last line becomes a figure of Christ and Christ's enduring presence in the world. Great dray horse suggests the Christ who drags his cross up the hill of Calvary on Good Friday, and bright and battering sandal, the radiant, triumphant Christ who breaks down the door of hell, the door of his tomb on Easter morning. As Hopkins put it, smiting an anvil, sawing a beam, whitewashing a wall, driving horses, sweeping, scouring, everything gives glory to God if being in his grace, you do it as your duty. The incarnate God is enduringly present in the world he has created. Hopkins again, I walk, I lift up heart, eyes, down all that glory in the heavens to gleam our Savior. And eyes, heart, what looks, what lips yet gave you a more rapturous love's greeting of realer, of rounder replies. Felix Randall, a poem written in 1880, suggests the complex and dynamic ways in which Hopkins felt the presence of the living God. R.S. Thomas's poem, which we'll look in a moment, Evans, through its opening question and its content, explicitly recalls Hopkins's Felix Randall, but it tells a very different story. Evans, probably not right. Evans, yes, many a time I came down his bare flight of stairs into the gaunt kitchen with its wood fire, where crickets sang accompaniment to the black kettle's whine, and so into the cold dark to smother in the thick tide of night that drifted about the walls of his stark farm on the hill ridge. It was not the dark filling my eyes. Sorry. It was not the dark filling my eyes and mouth that appalled me, nor even the drip of rain like blood from the one tree weather tortured. It was the dark silting the veins of that sick man I left stranded upon the vast and lonely shore of his bleak bed. A priest has again come to visit the dying, but this visit has brought no comfort to the priest or to his parishioner. The adjectives that describe the house and yard, bare, gaunt, stark, bleak, suggest the poverty, the hardship, the loneliness of the farmer's life. As he leaves the house, the priest is blinded by the darkness of his surroundings and is by his inability to see anything beyond their shared suffering. Evans alone and ill in his bed, and the priest with his sense of inadequacy, his sense of failure. If the incarnate God is present in the world, he does not reveal himself. He does not comfort his creatures. While the rain like blood on the one weather-tortured tree may recall the crucifixion, and the transcendent meaning it might give to human suffering. It may also only be a coincidental presence, an ironic echo, and not at all a sign of God's providential love, either for the dying man or for the priest. At the same time, the form of the poem is as austere as the world it describes. Simple descriptive words create the bleak landscape in which the priest serves and the farmer lives, very like the one in which Thomas spent his ministerial life. The short run-on lines often have a periodic effect, promising and then revealing darker details from one line to the next. And so into the cold dark to smother in the thick tide of night. If R.S. Thomas's vision of the world seems profoundly different from that of Gerard Manley Hopkins, his austere poetic style here seems the antithesis of Hopkins's formal, ornate, alliterative science. But in each case, form is appropriate to the vision. In Hope of Revelation, much of R.S. Thomas's religious poetry expresses that hope, even while recognizing that revelation is unlikely. Here is another poem, The Empty Church. I won't go back to adjust it. There's a couple of lines that I haven't caught there. One, the last line I don't have, but they laid this stone trap for him, enticing him with candles, as though he would come like some huge moth out of the darkness to beat there. Nah, he had burned himself before in the human flame and escaped, leaving the reason torn. He will not come anymore to our Lord. Why then do I kneel still, striking my prayers on a stone heart? Is it in hope one of them will ignite? Yet and throw on its illuminated walls the shadow of someone greater than I can understand. The image of God at the beginning of the poem seems, matter of fact, entirely appropriate to the location and utterly audacious. God is a great moth lured by the flame of candles and then burned, as moths often are, by them. He will not come anymore. His time in the mortal world has taught him to keep clear of humankind. And yet the priest still kneels, hoping at best for a shadow, some momentary intimation of whoever God is. Silence, waiting for the revelation that never comes, for some signal, to put it as he did in John Ormond's film, from an ever-present reality. Moments of great calm, kneeling before an altar of wood in a stone church in summer, waiting for the God to speak. The air of a staircase for silence. The sun's light ringing me, as though I acted a great role, and the audience is still. All that closed throng of spirits waiting as I, for the message. Prompt me, God, but not yet. When I speak, though it be you who speak through me, something is lost. The meaning is in the waiting. As Thomas explained in the film that John Ormond made about him, he said this: when one went into the church in one's own parish, especially in the evening dark, there was this same loneliness and quietness. Same, he said, as when he had walked alone on the moors. This same loneliness and quietness, because nobody ever goes into a country church. The parishioners don't seem to go into church. One is alone there again, and there is this struggle to balance off the urgency of one's own need for revelation with the need for patience. God, reality, whatever it is not going to be forced. It's not going to be put to the question. It works in its own time. And out of this, of course, comes the feeling that perhaps this is all that one is required to do. And then Thomas remembered Milton, they also serve who only stand and wait. Waiting for answers that never come, finding God by feeling his absence are, I would say, themselves acts of faith. The priest in R.S. Thomas's poem apparently lived always in the silence. The revelation he hoped for never came. The waiting never ended. One of the poems he published in his last collection, I think appropriately called No Peace with the Furies, is a poem called Silence. The relation between us was silence. That and the feeling of each one being watched by the other. I by an enormous pupil in a blank face, he by one in a million wanderers in the darkness that was never a long way off from his presence. It had begun by my talking all the time, repeating the worn formulas of the churches in the belief that that was prayer. Why does silence suggest disapproval? The prattling ceased, not suddenly, but as flowers die off in a frost, my requests thinned. I contented myself. I was answering his deafness with dumbness. My tongue lolled, clapper of a disused bell that would never again pound on him. Now there's two more stanzas, and I won't go back and try to move it. I'll just read them. What are the emotions of God? There was no admiring my restraint, no suggestion even of a recompense for my patience. If he had allowed himself but one word, his name, for instance, spoken ever so obliquely, my own, that for all his majesty acknowledged my existence. And yet there were creatures around me with their ears pricked. Figures on ancient cathedrals, the denizens of art, with their rapt, innocent faces and heads on side, as though they were listening. Ah, but to what? But the priest, like the two tramp, but the priest, let me get out of here for a minute, okay. But the priest, like the two tramps in Waiting for Godot, kept his appointments, and in having done so, brings hope to those who read his poems. As Barry Morgan, the Archbishop of Wales, put it on the centenary of Thomas's birth, R.S. Thomas continues to articulate through his poetry questions that are inscribed on the hearts of most Christian pilgrims in their search for meaning and truth. We search for God, and feel him near at hand, only then to blink and find him gone. This poetry persuades us that we are not alone in this experience of faith. The poet has been there before us. There's an epilogue, always an epilogue. If the priest in R.S. Thomas's poetry never encounters the God for whom he waits in church, reciting the formulaic words and rituals of ritual and prayer. See, inside the stone church. The man who lived in the Welsh countryside may have had a different experience, may have caught in its landscape, the landscape of Wales, what he called sudden glimpses of eternity. As R.S. Thomas told John Ormond in the film they made, it is difficult, if not impossible, while we are in flesh, to dwell permanently in what I would call the kingdom of heaven. But that it is close, and that we get these overtones, that we get these glimpses of it, is certainly my most deeply held conviction. Perhaps R.S. Thomas might, after all, have said with Gerard Manley Hopkins, I greet him the days I meet him, and bless when I understand. Thank you.
Really enjoyable reading of the poems, beautiful poems.
They are, yes. So I apologize for all the futzing about it.
Forget about it. Angela Preston is regularly sends in really good questions for us on these programs. She says, John Ormond asks deep philosophical questions in his poems and concludes often with, the questions are unanswerable. While Jeremy Hopkins offers hope in God, even in death, R.S. Thomas seems to struggle with hope in God. Is the difference between the poems the strength and weakness of faith or the winding path of faith?
That I think what strikes me about, I hope I get some kind of answer to that question. What strikes me about R.S. Thomas is that notion that, and of John Ormond as well, is the idea that to feel the absence of God is in itself an act of faith. Someone proposed that to John Ormond, saying, you know, that if you struggle with the sense of loss of God, that is faith or an act of faith. And John Ormond said, no, I don't feel that way. He felt very acutely the loss of faith or even a community of belief, and felt that, you know, then and at least in his public statements about it, said that, you know, he felt the loss. And the same is true with R.S. Thomas, but in a different way, I think. He too hopes for some affirmation or some sense that God has recognized that God is present in his life, maybe that's the way to put it, and that sense never comes, at least not. And see, that's the odd thing at the end of it. It may be it means not in his life as a minister of the word in the Church of Wales, but he did say that he felt glimpses of what he longed for out in the countryside. He described himself as a nature mystic, and in some ways, there's in that film by John Ormond, there's a beautiful description of the sunshine in Wales and how the beauty of the landscape was an intimation of God's presence. So, and for Hopkins, of course, Hopkins had his time of darkness, the so-called terrible sonnets, when he felt very much the absence and loss of God, and sort of, you know, tried to continue carrying out his faith without much return, a sense of God's presence in his life. Faith without work, without very much the sense that faith is being recognized, or that faith is bringing you some understanding and experience of God.
This, Mike, in the context of a continuity, I think you're going right back to Coleridge or going to Browning, or Coleridge within the Ancient Mariner, or going to Browning, you know, you cannot have faith without doubt. Is it within a continuity, or is this different from that?
Well, I see them, R.S. Thomas and John Ormond, and many other contemporary poets, modern poets, 20th century poets, who are, for whom the old sureties, as they used to say, we learned this in school, are gone. To put it in the cliched form, millions dead in the First World War. Is it possible that there is, how can you believe in a God? And, the foundations, the metaphysical foundations of the culture being shaken and so on. And these people are at a loss, and they're because they're sensitive to what is going on in the culture, It seems to me that's the source of, or the root cause of their struggle. They can't believe without doubt, and they try. Part of what they're all doing, Ormond, R.S. Thomas, is trying to, and we talked earlier about Wallace Stevens trying to make order, and Yeats to try to make order and meaning out of art, out of poetry, in some way, and that if there is the flying homing pigeons there, what he's trying to recognize in that poem, I think John Ormond is trying to do is my poem has an order to it, as I try to, maybe excessively explain that that is a carefully crafted poem put together, very ordered. The order of the pigeons might, we imitate, we create order in the poetry. We see the order of the pigeons. We hope that that in some way, beyond the apparent existential reality of the world, there is something larger, transcendent, that gives meaning to things. Ormond has a poem about salmon going up river to get to their, what do they do, their breeding area. What is it that draws them there? It's the same idea that there must be order somewhere. If there's an order in nature, there may be an order in the larger world, as in the human world as well.
Yeah, you mentioned Wallace Stevens there, that criticism tends to say that both Ormond and R.S. Thomas were actually influenced by him, because he was an atheist until his deathbed, apparently, or just before his deathbed. But you still get the same kind of image. I'm thinking of his great poem on Sunday morning, where we live in an old chaos of the sun, or island solitude, unsponsored, free of that wide water, inescapable. And then he gives that this wonderful description of the flock of birds flying towards the horizon, all in order. Yeah. But do you see a relationship between Wallace Stevens and them, or is he coming to it from a different angle altogether?
John Ormond was very much, I'm not sure influenced, but very much liked, and was found the poems of Wallace Stevens very powerful. He said that he came upon a poem by Wallace Stevens, read it, and he said he ran off to Waterstone's bookshop. he ordered everything in print by Wallace Stevens, and there was that kindred idea of living in an existential world, and here was somebody who was whose project, I think, Ormond recognized as in some ways his own project, that is Ormond's own project, this idea of art making or substituting or finding order, and poetry as a way of giving, maybe Frost's idea, a momentary stay against confusion. And so I think that would be the relationship there. I would not want to speculate about R.S. Thomas and Wallace Stevens, although there is a poem about Wallace Stevens by R.S. Thomas.
Thanks for that. Catherine Temple refers back to Angela Preston's question. How do you see the relationship between form and, for instance, the poetry of uncertainty versus Hopkins' more hopeful approach and Thomas's dark vision?
Form. Yeah. Well, Hopkins first, of course. It is highly, the poetry he wrote was highly ornate. He said himself at least two to Robert Frost said, if you don't structure your poetry and use meter and rhyme and so on, it's like playing tennis without a net. Hopkins erected two nets for himself. The whole the alliterative patterns, which were so important in his poetry, as well as very often, not entirely, the sonnet form. And so, for whatever psychological reasons or temperamental reasons, Hopkins needed a highly rigorous form in which to write. But of course, there again, it's the idea you create this beautiful poem, you are, for Hopkins, you're giving glory to God, you are joining your own work with the work of the Creator, and you're figuring forth in the beauty of the poem the presence of God in all things. God in all things. For Thomas, of course, it's just the opposite. There's no sense of comfort that in some way the sacrament that he brings to Evans has any efficacy in any apparent way. There's no sign. And he's writing about people who live in a very austere landscape, who live very austere lives, who are poor, and his own, the austerity of what the religion brings. It doesn't bring great waves of joy and triumph and possibility and sense of possibility. It's simply going through the motions of doing it, because it's what, and Thomas apparently was a good priest. Yeah, he was an Orthodox. His theology, at least publicly, was Orthodox. He carried out his work, but the austerity of the poems that talk about his life, talk about that world, the Welsh world in which he lives, recognize both the kind of the economic, the physical, it's a tough and wild place, as well as the religious austerity that the poems there are suitable to the vision, it seems to me. For Ormond, it may be a couple of one thing that might it's a more ornate and certainly a very much concerned with craftsmanship in an attempt, I think, to somehow find order somewhere in the world. Ormond went to art school while he was at university, and to that sense of being an artist, of making things, I think was very important to him.
I might come back to that if we've got time, but some other questions are coming in. Now, Angela's come back with a question. R.S. Thomas talks about the emotions of God. We see God described in the Bible as angry at sin, joyful at creation, and tender towards people. How did recognizing God's emotions influence his faith?
Well, I think that the question, what are the emotions of God? I think for him, it's God keeps his emotions under wraps. it seems I think that's what Thomas is in some way longing for, that God has some emotional response to the prayers. And it seems to me, I haven't read every poem that R.S. Thomas has written, because he wrote quite a few, but it seems to me that the God is under, keeps his emotions to himself, does not reveal himself. If he has emotions, they are not revealed. There's nothing coming back, if you like, when you say your prayers. So I'm not sure that I, as I said, as far as I can tell, there, I don't think he ever set out to describe or to try to characterize the emotions of God. It's interesting that the one biblical sort of reference that in that poem Silence, when he says, if he had but spoken one word, his name, for instance, it makes you think of that moment in when the God appears in the burning bush and reveals himself. But there's that doesn't happen in poems by R.S. Thomas.
I'd just like to say
one more thing. I would like to think more or try to find out more about that idea of in the church it doesn't work, in the countryside it does. You know, God is there in the landscape, but he's not in the church. And then that gets into the question of language. R.S. Thomas liked the Book of Common Prayer, didn't like the Welsh translations and so on. That would be some interesting questions there. But anyway.
Well, in Bleak Liturgies, Thomas asks, shall we revise the language? And in revising the language, will we alter the doctrine? However, I'll leave it at that because Tony Ead, who again is someone who's very faithful to us on this series, is always with us. And he says, Thomas seems to me a wonderful poet, but a lonely, isolated individual who, as you say, encountered the divine, insofar as he did, in nature more than through prayer or other traditional religious practices. Did he write at all about encountering God, the divine, through relationships with other people?
No, not to my knowledge. As again, I have not read every poem that he wrote. We do Thomas a disservice today because all I focused on were some of the religious poems, Christian spirituality, but he is known too as a love poet. And I had one of his love poems ready in case the question came up, but he's known as a love poet. But again, it does not seem that he finds God in the relationship. There's a little pamphlet of poems called R.S. Thomas Love Poems. And there's also, of course, a lot of political poems about the people of Wales, their lives, about he was a Welsh nationalist. So there's many poems about the exploitation and repression of Wales by the English. He's got, there's this poem, he says, there are places in Wales I don't go, reservoirs that are the subconscious of a people, referring to the practice of flooding the valleys in Wales to create reservoirs which would bring water to England.
There was a lot going on at that time in Welsh politics before devolution, which led to devolution. One last question, perhaps. Harry Blumeyers wrote that R.S. Thomas is worried by the decay of rural life, the creeping erosion of Welsh culture and identity. But there's no sentimentalization of the human reality. No one could have portrayed the hill farmers with more distaste for the brutishness of their ways or with more compassion. How do you consider his attitude to Wales, following on from the last question, and to its established church, if not its also its chapels?
Yeah, it well, as I understand it, he was a good priest. There's a story in the film that John Ormond made of him. He referred to the resurrection as a metaphor. And Ormond gave him the opportunity to recant on film, and he didn't. He said that the He thought of the resurrection as a metaphor. He said, I write poetry, I'm in the business of metaphors. The resurrection is a metaphor. But apparently when he worked as a priest, he was a very, unorthodox in every way. He did not impose any of his own ideas into the ministry. At the same time, he was a wealth nationalist. He was in and wrote poetry about that as well. His portrayal of the Welsh farmers which he worked. There's a poem about there's lots of poems, and he's not very sympathetic about toward their lifestyle or anything, but he is, as you see in the poem Evans, the one about Davies, those people, there's also great compassion as well. He was apparently a very complex man and a very difficult man. I remember talking to another Welsh poet, Roland Matthias. You know, he says, I'm afraid. I asked him, what's Thomas like? He said, I'm afraid of him. I said, he's a rough and wild man. He said, I really don't like to have anything to do with him. Ormond had thicker skin, and probably when they made the movie, he got something out of him. But as I said, a lot of people found him very, very, very off-putting, very, very difficult, cranky in some ways.
Well, he was certainly living in a rough and wild place in Wales, and he was in the northwest yeah. West of Wales. And whereas Hopkins resided in Wales for quite a time, where most of his poems that we have were written at St Beino's near St Asaph, looking over the valley, and it's a little softer terrain, even though it's a valley and the hills, but softer, I think, than where Thomas was. But that's another kind of discussion. But in fact, yeah. You've talked about three Welsh poets in a sense, even though, of course, Hopkins was English, but three Welsh poets in the sense that he wrote so many of his poems in Wales. So thank you, Mike, for such an informative and as ever enthusiastic session from you.
You
might like to note, everybody, that Mike Collins and I have edited the collection of talks from our first series, the series which was Christian Shakespeare ? And this is going to be published by the Vernon Press in the autumn. And I'd like to take this opportunity really to thank you, Mike, for all your work on that particular project. Now, you've put in a lot of work for that, and we're very grateful and look forward to the book. Our next event in this series will be on Tuesday, the 15th of March, when Bridget Keegan will be discussing the Irish writer James Field Stanfield, and particularly the Guinea Voyage and the problem of evil. Another event which you might like to note is the Free Speech Project at the Crossroads International Dialogues, which is done in association with the Future of Humanities Project, and that will be on Monday, the 21st of March, when we'll be discussing something, again, very contemporary, because we're going to discuss veterans. We're going to discuss what happens to people after war. And of course, today, our hearts and minds are with the terrible events that are going on in the Ukraine. But that will be on Monday, the 21st of March. Will you please note that this will be at 11 a.m. EST as normal, but that will be 3 p.m. BST, and that's 3 p.m. in the UK, as the UK will not have moved their clocks forward. The US does it 1 week before the UK, so we get this kind of strange time gap. It goes down to the 4 hours instead of the five. And our next China event is on Friday, the 8th of April at 9 a.m. EST, p.m. BST, that's British Summertime, and that will be a panel discussion chaired by Tom Banchoff, the Vice President of Global Affairs at Georgetown, and it will be concerning the Jesuits and China. And that should be a really good discussion. That's Friday, the 8th of April at 9 a.m. or 2 p.m. We'd like to thank those at Georgetown who've made this happen, especially our administrators, Julia Murillo and Mary Gordon. Further thanks at Georgetown, of course, to Tom Banchoff, the Vice President, but also to Dr. Jack DeJoy, the President. At Campion Hall, to Dr. Nick Austin, the Master, Joe Simmons, who's my co-convener, and Sarah Gray and Ying Ying, our administrators there. At Blackfriars, Richard Finn, OP, Director of the Las Casas Institute, and Dr. John O'Connor, OP, the Regent, and King Arona Gabnai, our administrator. My thanks, as always, to Maggie Scott. And finally, my thanks to you for being part of the audience. Thank you for the really great questions that came in today. Please join us again for some of these events. In the meantime, take care, keep safe, remember Ukraine in your prayers. I'm Mike Scott. Please follow me on Twitter @MikeScottProf. Thank you and goodbye.